to part two of painting our boat. We're going to touch on a few of the pieces of equipment. In part one, we just briefly went over that you need kit. You need certain items that are going to make your job a lot easier. One thing you have to remember is obviously we're professionals and I wouldn't say kit is no option, but we do try to make sure we've got everything to hand. And we'll often, and you may see it later in the video, we've got more than one of everything. It makes a big difference not having to change from, say, a cleaning up wheel to a wire brush with the same piece of kit. For us, it's easy. We just pick up a different piece of kit, use it, put it down, on with the next piece. So if you can double up, it helps. It's not essential. Just means you're going to use a bit of time up swapping and changing. Don't forget your hand tools. People think everything's got to be done by machine. There are a lot of cases where hand scrapers and smaller tools get into all the little corners and help make your life a lot easier. One bit of kit that we find absolutely invaluable at times is a needle gun. You need a compressor. You can hire this sort of thing, but for getting in all those corners where scrapers or there's weld splatter or the weld is uneven and it's difficult to use scrapers and smaller tools, then a needle gun is absolutely first rate. It'll clean up very quickly, leave you a surface which you can prime straight onto pretty much, which I've had a clean round. And it does knock away weld splatter and things like that that may have been left from the first time the boat was painted. We'll have a look at some of the kit once we're actually starting to take some of this paint off and demonstrate it as we go through. One thing you will find using this equipment is the need for PPE. You're going to need a decent dust mask, ear defenders, as it is a very noisy operation, and some good eye protection. Not just for you. If there's anybody else working in the workshop with you, you've hired a workshop or you're in a polytunnel, then make sure they've all got this and they're aware that they need to wear it at all times. This piece of kit does fire shards of paint or spin shards of paint off the head. It can go in all directions. Sometimes the ones you hire have sort of a rubber barrier which is sort of spring loaded, so make sure that stays in contact. They still do manage to fire loose paint in various directions, but make sure that's fitted and operational to reduce the amount of paint shards that you're going to fire around. Now we're going to fire this one up in a second, and we'll just show you a small area and show you what actually gets left behind. The biggest tip I can give you using one of these is to run it slow. You can always speed it up if you think that's necessary. The slower you run it, it gives the teeth a chance to actually bite into the paintwork and remove it. Another reason for running it slow, if you run it at high speed and it wobbles or there's any user error in that, you will scar the steel and you actually dig in, which at some later date you're going to have to fill or make a light repair to. So keep it flat on the steel, work it at a fairly slow speed, and you should be all right. There we have it. Worth having a closer look at that. What you've actually done there is you've removed the paint. The grey areas are often primer that tends to be softer and maybe adhered better to the steel. This is not finished, this is not ready to paint on. What we need to do now, and we'll show you that process, is you need to sand or prep this surface ready for taking some paint and removing any flaking old bits and just getting a good surface for that initial coat of primer. Let's have a look at the sander. Okay, over to the sanding side. This is one we did earlier. Basically, we've scabbled this side, and we're working as a team here today. So I've scabbled this side of the boat and the roof, and David's working along behind me, dressing up the steel. Basically, all we're doing is we're just taking off this old paint, this old primer, anything that the scabble hasn't taken, and we're just taking that and putting on here a nice surface ready for us to paint. And once we've done the sides, we do the roof, clean up all the other bits and pieces. What we try to do is to make sure, and what you need to do is make sure the whole surface is prepped, ready for your coat of primer. Again, I'll mention the PPE. A sander will produce a certain amount of dust, and obviously fine dust. You don't want to be breathing in potentially quite harmful dusts created as we sand. A good quality sander is always a good idea. This is just the ones we use. This is getting on a bit, but one that we tend to use more for the rough work. It's a professional sander. They're not overly expensive to buy. Dust extraction, however, is fairly important. A lot of these sanders, when you buy them, they come with just a little dust extraction bag, which is fine. But the more you can remove using a Hoover, the better. The old Henry Hoovers, there are other Hoovers available, I'm sure, but this one seems to work particularly well. It's got a good amount of suck on it, but it's also got a bag in there which also stops the Hoover blowing out a lot of additional dust. So for this job we use 120 grit, and we're on the Velcro type. You don't need expensive discs for this. I use a much higher quality disc when I'm looking at sanding glosses and undercoats, but for a basic taking back, 120 sort of the cheaper range of discs is fine. So I'm going to pop my dust mask on and we'll show you what we're looking at. So there you have it. Not much to it. It's basic sanding. Change the discs regularly. There's no point in trying to polish the steel. And what we're talking about, what actually is achieved here, this is removing paint. About a 120 grade, takes that paint off quite cleanly. You should be aware that all paint requires an anchor pattern or a key for it to adhere to the steel. If we feel it's necessary, we'll go over the whole cabin side and any bare steel with something a little coarser, maybe a 30 coarse disc, just purely to ensure that we haven't polished the steel and the primer's got something to stick to. This particular one, the welding has been a little less than we would have hoped for. And we've got some specialists in that are going to dress this up so there's no need for filler and we can leave it in absolutely tip-top condition. And we're going to move down and we're going to watch this professional finish off the handrails to the best best conditions. So that's the end of this clip, and we'll see you again on one of the next ones.